welcome from Tony and myself to our Good Afternoon Consumer program. Over the past few weeks, we've talked about prices and how the Price Commission works, and we've discussed how our standard of living will be affected by rising inflation. But today, we're going to take a look at what may change both our standard of living and prices. We're taking our own consumer program look at the election. Don't worry, though, we're not going to be talking about the miners or the energy crisis or issues like that. We're sticking to our own subject when we ask, what do the political parties offer the consumer? That's you and me, the shoppers. To answer our question, we have Sir Geoffrey Howe, Minister for Trade for Consumer Affairs, Shirley Williams, Labour's Shadow Minister for Prices and Consumer Affairs in the last Parliament, and Des Wilson, representing the Liberals.
And with the news that the price of Britain's food has risen by half since 1970 for whatever reason, we look firstly at the topic that is worrying everyone just now, and that is how to control rising prices. So let's start, if we may, with Sir Geoffrey Howe. Sir Geoffrey, the Price Commission, which you set up last year to control prices, clearly needs to be more effective. Indeed, in your manifesto, you propose that the Price Commission has the powers it needs to protect the consumer. Let me ask you this, why hasn't it had these powers before, and what new powers are you proposing to give it?
Well, in fact, it has got very tough powers already. They're the toughest price control powers we've ever seen in peacetime in this country. And if I can give you just one example, the profit made by retailers, ordinary retail stores and supermarkets, was about threepence halfpenny in the pound at the beginning of stage two of our prices policy. It's come down now to just under threepence in the pound. You can see the same sort of movement as far as co-ops are concerned. Their divvies haven't been going up because there aren't any profits to be made in it. But we have given the Price Commission, in the code already, powers to examine the margins of profit being made on particular products. They are now exercising those powers. They're conducting an examination. And if they find that any particular product can have its actual profit margin reduced, then of course we shall act on that. But I wouldn't like you to believe that there's any great scope for reduction in prices, even if we toughen it for a very great deal. Most of the bakeries in this country, the three large bakery groups, are in fact making bread at a loss at the present time. There are about 5,000 small bakers who make about a fifth of all the bread we eat, and they're all facing real difficulty. There's one bakery unit in Harold Wilson's constituency, which he opened not many years back. It employs 200 people. Even that is running at a loss. And if we try to squeeze profits either of manufacture or distribution any further, he might have the privilege of closing it as well.
Yes, so you're saying then that you're just going to ensure that the Price Commission does the job which it's already set up to do. You're not anticipating giving it any new powers?
Well, we are prepared to give it whatever new powers seem to be sensible and necessary. It is already looking, under the powers it's already got, at the margins being charged on particular foods. It's looking right the way through the food industry. If they can identify any area where some change could be made, we shall certainly act on that. But nobody should believe that one can squeeze very much more out of prices by tougher control of that kind. It is very, very tough already.
Surely a lot of people have said there should be controls over the prices on fresh food.
It's very difficult to control the prices on fresh food because the prices of fresh food depend on what the producer can actually get on world markets. And it's been impossible anywhere around the world to control that. You see, farmers, people who produce fresh food, have got to be able to get a fair return, a good return, at the market price on what they produce. What we do control is the profit made right the way through distribution from there on, and the profit made by manufacturers of food. The price of raw materials used by food manufacturers have gone up by about 50 pence in the pound in the last year. And in this country, the price of the goods they actually turn out at the end of the day has gone up by only 14 pence in the pound. That shows just how tightly we are squeezing them.
Well, Shirley Williams, your Labour manifesto says that you'll introduce strict price controls on key services and commodities. What are the new controls and how will they differ from the Conservatives' Price Commission?
They would differ quite a lot because I don't really accept all that Geoffrey Howe has said. And at the moment I'm labouring under a great sense of grievance because having conceded to the Conservative Party that world food prices have risen and no government can do anything about that, I'm really very annoyed that they then suppressed what I went on to say, which was that I thought there were effective ways in which we could control prices, and let me repeat what they are in my view. I think first and foremost that we should go back to where we were at stage one of the prices code, and that was a control over cash margins and not just percentage profit, margins. We know that there was an approach by the Prices Commission to the government last October, at least so we're informed by The Guardian, and I have no reason to disbelieve it, in which they asked for the power to control cash margins because of the effect of inflation of raw materials, which drive up percentage margins in cash terms all the time. We know now too that the government rejected that under pressure from the retail consortium led by a former Conservative chief whip. So the first point I want to make is that Labour feels very strongly that in a period of inflation you must control cash margins and not just percentage margins, and we believe this can also be applied to fresh food. It's done in France. It's been done in the past in the Netherlands. We simply don't accept it can't be done here. One other point, and that is that we believe that we could also control, to some extent at least, speculation in the commodity markets. We know that even very respectable conservative kinds of journal, like The Economist, have argued that both fresh food prices and commodity speculation could be controlled. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting that The Economist attributes something like a third to a half of the increase in food prices to the fact that we do not have any control over fresh food prices by the Price Commission at all.
But how
Labour would certainly extend the powers of the Price Commission to the fresh food area. We would certainly give them the power to control cash margins, and we would certainly take powers to limit forward buying on commodity markets at the present time.
How would you do that? How would you control speculating?
Well, on the first one, we only require the mandatory bringing in of the prices code, paragraph 80 of the prices code, which would make it possible for the Commission to control cash margins. Mm. On commodity speculation, it's fair to say, I think, that in 1972, the currency markets were so controlled by controls over the forward buying of sterling. What we are arguing is that there should be similar controls in the commodity markets, and this would effectively be done by setting up commodity commissions, which would be public commodity commissions, to do their own purchasing in periods of shortage, surplus, and then to release the commodities in periods of shortage.
Well, we'll be coming back to the whole question of commodities in a moment, but let's turn, if we may, to Des Wilson. Now, Des, the Liberals say that they will control rising prices with, quote, a permanent prices policy enforced by penalties on those whose actions cause inflation. What controls do you, in fact, propose, and what penalties will you introduce?
Yes, can I make it clear that the prices that can be controlled in that way are the prices that rise because of home factors? You do have to separate, as Shirley Williams made clear, the prices that are caused by world factors and the prices that are caused at home. And in our view, if you cannot control the rise of a price because the rise occurs overseas, then the only thing you can do is help people to pay that. And no doubt we'll come to that a little later on.
Yes, indeed.
For a moment, talking about how we can control prices at home, I'd just like to make a comment about the Price Commission. Sir Geoffrey's made the point that he thinks it's about as tough as it can be. And I noticed a week ago that he said that it had stopped something like 200 rises in a week. But you know, the Price Commission has approved over 3,400 price increases this year alone. In other words, in 6 weeks. Now that doesn't seem to me to be very tough control of prices. And
no,
one way whereby I think that the Prices Commission could be made tougher is in controls on medium-sized companies. At the moment, it's very loose in terms of its controls on medium-sized companies. But as for the Liberal policy, what we want to see is some situation whereby we can get an effective prices and incomes policy working. Now, at the moment, as you know, the Conservative and Labour Party have moved onto opposite sides of the fence to that they were in 1970. At that time, Harold Wilson believed in a compulsory incomes policy, and Edward Heath believed that on no account should you have a compulsory incomes policy. Now these parties have done a complete double take. We've always believed in a prices and incomes policy. We believe the most effective way of imposing it is through the tax system, by punishing people for excessive profits, punishing people for taking excessive wages through taxation.
Shirley Williams, I'd like to move on to subsidies now. The Conservatives maintain that the overall cost of food subsidies is prohibitive. Yet you say you will introduce selective food subsidies. What items will you subsidise?
We would subsidise the items that loom largest in the budgets of those who are on very small incomes, particularly pensioners and large families with low incomes.
What items?
And these would be, yes, I'll be precise. These would be certainly to start with, we think, bread, cheese, margarine, and probably, and I've said probably because there are certainly problems about doing this, eggs. We hope it may be possible to subsidise the cheaper cuts of meat, but I will not say for certain that we can, because the difficulty with meat is that it's open-ended. People can switch from other goods to meat, for example from fish to meat, if it's subsidised, so it's very hard to estimate what it would cost. We estimate that the cost of subsidising these basic goods I've given you, and also in continuing the subsidy on milk, would be about £500 million, and we believe that this sum could come from removing the tax reliefs on surtax payers, which Mr. Barber made in his budget of 1971, the estimated value of that being about the same sum, £500 million.
Sir Geoffrey Howe, the government has just announced a £150 million increase in milk subsidies, and Mr. Heath has not ruled out the possibility, that is, of further food subsidies. What's your attitude to food subsidies, and what others do you have on the shopping list besides milk? Meat, for instance?
No, as Shirley Williams has explained, meat raises very real difficulties, and of course, she hasn't suggested, and I can understand why, subsidising the whole range of manufactured food, which accounts for about 50% of the ordinary housekeeping budget. We do, as you say, subsidise milk, largely because the production of that is almost entirely within the UK. It's one of the very few commodities that falls into that category. But even to keep the price of milk down by a penny a pint costs £130 million. Now, Shirley Williams' £500 million would amount to that kind of thing. And we've not ruled them out altogether, but I wouldn't want anyone to believe that they would go very far in helping keeping prices down against rising world prices. If we tried to keep them down to what they were a year ago by subsidies, this is all food prices, that would have cost £1,600 million. And this is why one's got to face the uncomfortable facts. That's why we've been concentrating the extra money we've got on raising social benefits, on keeping pensions ahead of prices, raising pensions every year. And we've promised now to raise them every 6 months. It's best, I think, to concentrate the help on the people who really need it, rather than subsidising even bread rolls in the Savoy, which is what Shirley Williams would be doing.
Not many bread rolls are eaten in the Savoy compared to plain loaves eaten by housewives and large families.
I know, but it
does, Wilson. I'd like to ask you what the Liberal attitude is towards subsidies.
Well, I think basically I would accept the main point that Geoffrey Howe made. We wouldn't rule out perhaps a temporary subsidy until such time as one sorted out one's policies in terms of prices. But basically there are two arguments against subsidies as I see it. The first, and I think this was the main point Geoffrey Howe was making, is that you're subsidising everyone, the rich and the poor alike. And this seems a colossal waste of money and not a particularly effective way of helping those who need it most. The second thing is this, that if the price continues to rise, the overseas price, then it must follow that if you believe in subsidy at the beginning, you'll have to keep subsidising. And where does it end? If the price doubles, you can imagine the public money going into subsidies rising at a colossal rate. And this money has to be raised off the taxpayer, so in a way we're subsidising ourselves. We believe the only way to help people pay overseas prices is to link the incomes of the lower paid pensioners and those who are most vulnerable to high food prices, to link their rise in incomes to rising food prices. I think you can do this by whatever incomes policy you have, giving them the right to negotiate increases if food prices rises above the figure that you originally agreed with them.
I'd like to
ask Des Wilson one question.
Yes, do.
Well, there are two things about that that seem to be fairly extraordinary. Pensioners aren't really in much of a position to negotiate, so I don't know quite what he means by they can negotiate on the basis of increased food prices. And I've certainly never seen any Liberal policies that says that pensions will be linked to the food index. If so, that's news to me. It's not in their manifesto. And the other question I want to ask him is this. How does he, and for that matter Geoffrey Howe, deal with the fact that something like 1 million pensioners don't claim supplementary benefit at all, that something like half those entitled to family income supplement don't claim it at all. The trouble with means-tested benefits of the kind that Sir Geoffrey relies so much upon is that a great many people, rightly or wrongly, are too proud to claim them. And you cannot reach those people, many of them very poor, except through, we believe, some form of subsidy.
Well, Shirley Williams is absolutely... Can I just answer that? And Shirley Williams is absolutely right to point out the vulnerability of pensioners under the way that both the Conservatives and Labour have helped pensioners up to now. But the answer to the question, how do we give subsidies to pensioners, is that Liberals believe in linking pensions to the average industrial wage, two-thirds of the average industrial wage for a couple and 50% for a single person. Now, this means that the pension automatically goes up as the average industrial wage goes up. So if a worker negotiates a price, a salary increase or a wage increase because the price has gone up and gets it and the average wage goes up, so will the average pension go up.
But this is fine, you see, because this in fact is what we've been doing. I agree with Shirley Williams. Indeed, I remember both of us, the very first time we spoke in the House of Commons, agreed in disliking means-tested benefits. Now, that's why this Conservative government has made provision, and is going to do so, for introducing a tax credit scheme so that everyone, pensioners and low-income families, will automatically get, in the same way as the rest of us pay income tax, additional benefits to cover their low incomes. But as far as pensions are concerned, this is what we have been doing. Prices generally have gone up, for the reasons we've all agreed on, by about 37 pence in the pound since June 1970. Average earnings have gone up by 50 pence in the pound, and the pension rising every year, instead of every couple of years with difficulty, under the last government, has gone up by 55 pence in the pound. And because we recognise the need for keeping pensioners even closer alongside, we're going to raise it every 6 months. But keeping the same sort of pattern, exactly as Des Wilson says, moving at least in line with average earnings. That's the way to help the people.
But really.
We must move on. With my very practical question. I'd like to ask you what you're going to do about this sort of thing. Now, here are two labels. An increased price label stuck on top of an old label, right? And that happens. The top label says 24 pence. The one underneath says 22 pence, right? This is something that we all find in the shops at times. What sort of things can you do to stop this? How can you regulate against this? Can I say,
of course it's annoying and irritating for that to happen, and I get as fed up as anyone else does if I do find it. In fact, the shopkeeper, you see, buys, shall we say, a stock of goods of one kind 6 months, 12 months ago, and he may pay 15 pence to buy them. He has them in stock, he's selling them gradually. Mm-hmm. He then has to stock up again and pay 20 pence because the world price has gone up.
Yes, but what about the old tins?
Well, the old tins may have been bought at the lower price, but he's not going to have enough capital with which to buy the new stuff at the higher price, in some cases, if he doesn't raise it. Now, he can't, in that kind of way, get away with big profits or unfair profits. I'll come back to the figures I mentioned, because the average profit being made by the retailer, the retail corner shop or the supermarket, is threepence halfpenny in a pound. Our price control has reduced that to threepence in a pound. It may be, in some cases, for the very efficient, fourpence a pound. For the small ones, a penny a pound. If you chopped it in half and knocked a penny halfpenny in the pound off by toughening up price control, you'd very quickly run the risk of running small shops, corner shops particularly, out of business.
Right.
That's
Shirley
the kind
Williams,
of margin we're playing with. It is very, very tight indeed.
Well,
what's your comment?
Two comments. One comment is that I don't really accept what Geoffrey Howe said, because we have seen an increase of 20-25% in the profits of food manufacturers and retailers.
This
is the Financial Times figures. They are given by the Financial Times. We have a quarrel about that, and we will argue about it.
I'll come back.
And also, the Economist has said on this too, that the Prices Commission, the phrase they use is, a coach and horses could be driven through the prices code on this matter. On your question, I think first that what one needs is lists in the shops, clearly giving the prices of various goods, as it were, this week. And I think we should have those lists up by law. I think they should be unit price lists so that the housewife knows what the cost is per pound and not according to some obscure package. And I think we've also got to make it quite clear that if package sizes change, or if package weights change, which is the other side of it, fewer peas in the tin, then there must be a clear indication of a change in weight or a change in the amount of toilet paper in a toilet roll or whatever it may be, because this is one of the things that makes housewives most bitter, and understandably so.
Des Wilson,
I think one of the things that we still lack in this country is a really effective consumer pressure movement. We must remember that Sir Geoffrey represents a government, one of whose very first measures was to close down the Consumer Council, which was the one organisation with the authority and the independence to have the potential to organise surveillance of this kind of thing at street level. Something I remember particularly well, because you may recall I was going to be director of that Consumer Council, but never got there. But in my mind, for all of the measures that the Conservatives have since taken, in appointing Sir Geoffrey to the position he holds, bringing in various legislation, they have never replaced the potential of the Consumer Council in terms of getting some kind of surveillance in the shops and pressure on the shops.
Right, so you want vigilance. Fine, more vigilance. Sir Geoffrey, I'd like to come to you now, because over the past few years, the Conservatives have been busy making new laws like the Fair Trading Act to protect the consumer. But are you satisfied that consumers really know their rights under the law and know how to complain if they're getting a raw deal?
No, they don't. Not sufficiently. That's why one of the first things I did when I took on my job was to start producing a regular bulletin of consumer information going out to all the advice centres and trading standards offices they go to. The Fair Trading Act, which we passed last year, established a Director General of Fair Trading and a Consumer Protection Advisory Council with much, much tougher powers, enforceable by law, than the Consumer Council ever had. And the Director General will be producing very shortly a guide to the consumer to his rights. We've given the consumer improved rights in the courts and produced a guide to that. We're producing a whole range of information of that sort. And I've held a number of conferences with local authorities in the last 12 months in order to give a more effective and wider network of consumer advice centres. We've got some being run by local authorities and about 500 being run by citizens' advice bureaus. I've made another £1.5 million available to increase the number of citizens' advice bureaus. And this is really effective action. Better rights in the courts, information about the rights in the courts, and an extension of consumer advice facilities.
Well, let's move on to our last question then, very briefly. For all the people who watch this programme, when they go into a shop, whether it's to buy a jar of pickles or a motor car, the feeling still exists that they're at the mercy of vast organisations against whom they have little or no redress. Now, what new plans have you got to help the individual consumer? Shirley Williams.
Let me say right away that I think some of the legislation that Geoffrey Howe has introduced has been very useful, and we've supported it as an opposition. I think the great weakness about it is that it's not effectively, it hasn't got effective sanctions behind it. There are two weaknesses as I see it. One is that the consumer doesn't know her rights, and secondly that if she knows them, she doesn't dare prosecute them. Now, this leads us to the view that it must be a local authority service, that you've got to have a powerful local authority consumer committee, which has laid on expert advice, weights and measures inspectors advice, and legal advice, to help the consumer and, if necessary, to fight the case for her all the way through. Because our experience is, and I think this will be commonly shared by viewers of your programme, that you may complain about the fact that your car hasn't been serviced, that you've been chiselled on your house quality, that you have bought the wrong goods in the shops, but then you can't take it further because you don't know what to do, you don't know how to approach the courts, and you can't afford to do it anyway. We must have a watchdog.
Because we're almost out of time. I want to come to you quickly in 1 minute, Sir Geoffrey Howe.
Well, in fact, Shirley's wrong to say we haven't given the consumer new power and new rights. Some of the legislation we've already passed does give the Weights and Measures Inspectorate power to get for the consumers not just a conviction, which is no good, but compensation as well. The Director General of Fair Trading has got power, which he'll shortly be exercising, to take to court unfair traders and get penalties against them. He's got power to make regulations about unfair trading practices. He announced yesterday he's beginning to make some on doorstep selling practices, on mail order firms who don't have a guaranteed delivery date, and on a number of other things.
But
they're real powers which the local authorities will be able to exercise. These are laws the Director General can propose,
thank you all
which they can enforce.
Very much indeed. Shirley Williams, gentlemen, thank you very much. Joan and I will be back in a fortnight's time to see you again when the shouting is over. Until then, bye bye.